I love Jonathan Glazer's sci-fi horror film, Under the Skin. But it isn't for everyone. No matter how incredible the cinematography and music may be, it has a lot of qualities that could put a lot of people off. It's slow, thematic, depressing, and very artsy-ish. Even though it came out fairly recently in 2014, sadly, it's rarely mentioned. When it is brought up, I've found it's often by those rejoicing over Scarlett Johansson's decision to go fully nude in it. I'm guessing most of her fans of the Marvel movies that flocked to this film were disappointed, though, because it's not a sexy movie. When I watch this film, I'm always too perplexed and disturbed to focus on the main character's beauty. I'm usually too caught up in at least trying to decipher its message. For this video essay, I'm going to tell you what I think this message is. But first, I need to stress that this is the sort of film that can be analyzed in many ways from many angles. While I believe there are constant, intentional themes to it, I doubt there's an objective, unchanging metaphorical meaning. I get the sense that the director was instead aiming for something a bit more subjective, more open to interpretation. People will have different opinions of this film, and that's okay. For instance, according to many video essays I've seen on the film, this film is about our culture's obsession with beauty standards. They say it's about finding inner beauty under the skin. But I disagree, sort of. Sure, I think it's certainly about finding what's under the skin, but I don't think this theme's relationship to beauty is what matters most here. And no, I'm not claiming to have cracked the code of what it's saying, I'm just relaying what it says to me. So, with all that out of the way, here's my interpretation. Under the Skin is about the disturbance in the sense of self. Its story showcases and is a metaphor for someone having an identity crisis. It's about feeling like you don't exist, like you don't have a concrete identity or even any individuality. It's about being in a human body, but not feeling human. This film is about the struggle of feeling like there's nothing coherent or consistent under the skin. Looking only at the surface layer of this film, or its skin, it appears to be a simple sci-fi story. Scarlett Johansson plays the female, an entity or creature of some kind that seduces and murders lonely men. After a while, she stops killing humans and decides to learn about them instead, and in the process, she tries to learn about herself. But this is just a quick synopsis. Let's explore this story with a bit more detail. In the first shot of the film, we see blackness, and then a pinprick of light ahead that grows large as it approaches. From a side angle, we can see that this light is shining through some sort of mysterious donut-like object. A black object moves away from the camera and inserts itself into the hole of the donut. Then, on the other side of this donut, we can see this black object surface up to the light as it rises through the hole. We are witnessing the fabrication of an artificial human eye. Throughout all these shots, as this eye is constructed, we hear a female voice making noises, like she's practicing certain sounds, as if learning how to speak. This is the female, our protagonist, being born. She is not someone, but something that is otherworldly. She could be an extraterrestrial or a machine built by extraterrestrials. Whatever she is, it isn't human. So, in these first shots of the film, we are literally under the skin of our main character, surrounded by the black emptiness that makes up her core. Once she is born, or built, her boss, or the bad man, as he's called in the credits, carries a woman to a white van. Inside a white void, which very well could be the interior of these aliens' white van, the bad man plops this woman onto the floor. Our main character strips this girl and changes into her clothes. A tear runs down this girl's face, showing the fragile emotions of human beings. Our protagonist ignores the woman's pain and instead examines an ant on her finger. This movie spends a lot of time focusing on this ant because it's important, but I'll get to that later in the video. The female's purpose on Earth is to hunt down males while disguised as a human. For the first half of the movie, we see her driving around town, night after night, looking gorgeous and luring men back to her lair. In her lair, she moves across the dark room, stripping off a few pieces of clothing to distract the men from the black void that surrounds them. By the time she's down to her underwear, the floor has turned to liquid and the men have sunk into it, trapped in the black abyss below. Soon they will die and be processed into a meat soup. Then all that will be left of the men is their skin, floating like a piece of clothing in the dark liquid. The female hunts for men who won't be missed. Loners, drifters, losers. To do her job properly, the men must believe she's human. And at a glance, she succeeds at this. She knows how to blend in, how to communicate, how to laugh and emote. But it's all fake. There's nothing behind her eyes. No spark, no soul. Just blackness. As she hunts and kills, she seems like a robot, completely apathetic. But if we look closer, it also seems, at least in moments, that there could be something more to her. Many times throughout the film, she simply watches the people, watches the crowd. In these sections, we see the people through her point of view. It makes us feel that we are really her. And with this footage being of real, unsuspecting people, you know, guerrilla filmmaking style, it really feels like we are observing something foreign from the outside. The female is fascinated by humans, their culture, behavior, and of course their fashion and makeup. Although she does have an excuse for being interested in these things. When she first changes clothes and applies lipstick, it could be for the purpose of being more sexually appealing, to be more efficient at hunting men. But then again, she also seems to be interested in the frivolous stuff too, as if the act of customizing her appearance is rewarding in and of itself. Even though the primary outfit she chooses is reminiscent of a hunter's clothing, there seems to be more to her than just hunting. While her main reason for exploring the nightlife of the city is to find her next victim, the childlike wonder she experiences in the process seems to hint at something more. Even if mostly subdued, she still feels things while out hunting. For instance, she seems taken aback when a group of people help her up after taking a fall. And then when a gang of men threaten to attack her, she appears to be legitimately afraid. Emotions like these show she isn't completely empty on the inside, or they at least hint at that. And the bad man must notice this too. He becomes suspicious that she's developing feelings, individuality, and identity. So he silently, maybe telepathically, interrogates her and studies her eyes, the gateways to the soul, for evidence. But he doesn't find any, because for the most part, there's no identity, there's no what we would call humanity within her for him to find. Her goal still is to seduce and destroy men, and that's exactly what she goes on doing without hesitation, until she meets a man with a disfigured face. This is a man who, for painfully obvious reasons, has issues with his own identity. His face is so badly deformed we can't even see his eyes. He only goes out at night because it's easier to avoid people. He can't connect with other humans. It's like he's detached from the entire species, like he doesn't fit in with them, just like the female. In this moment, the female recognizes this. It's almost like they have a bond. But even though they have so much in common, even though they connected, she still has a job to do. Like the other men before him, she traps him in the liquid floor by walking across it while stripping. But unlike the other victims, she lets this man see her fully naked. She lets all of herself be seen. But no matter how good a view he's treated to, she still traps him and leaves him for dead. But a moment later, she catches her reflection in a mirror. She studies her own eyes for a long time, and then notices a fly trapped between panes of glass. This inspires a change of heart, and she frees the man. She violates the rules, and then drives away, unsure of where she's going. As if telepathic, the bad man senses what's going on. He tracks down the deformed man and kills him. While driving without a destination, the fog ahead of her makes seeing the road impossible. She gets out of her van and goes into the fog on foot, unable to see or understand anything around her. A white void in all directions. While the bad man desperately searches for her to bring her back under his control, the female explores the surrounding area. Throughout this section of the film, she tries to learn everything she can about being a human, but everything she finds confuses her. She tries to eat, but she can't. She isn't human. She watches comedy and taps her finger to music. She rides on a bus and meets a man. She tries to connect with this man and even lets him attempt to have sex with her. but she can't. She isn't human. She runs away from the nice man and heads into the woods. When we cut back to the bad man, we see some things have changed. Instead of riding his motorcycle alone like before, he now has a gang of companions helping him search for the female. The female meets another man in the woods who seems to be kind and helpful. Humans have always been helpful to her. From what she has seen, most humans are harmless and pitiful. But this human is different. He corners her in the woods and tries to rape her. No longer is she hunting men. Now she is the prey. In the struggle, he tears her skin. Underneath her suit of fake flesh, she is colorless, featureless, like a mannequin, a fake person. The man is terrified by the sight of her. His only thought is to destroy whatever it is he's seeing, so he drenches her in fuel and burns her like a witch. When she finally falls dead to the ground, the black smoke rises and mixes into the foggy white and now snowing sky. Knowing what we know now, let's go back to that sequence when the female examines the ant. Why I think this shot is important is because she is very similar to this ant. Much more similar to it than she is to humans. Like the ant, she's black, emotionless, a pawn without an identity, defined by the hive mind she combines into. That's right, I believe the aliens are a hive mind. I think their intelligence, their decision maker, their brain, is the black liquid in their lair. Considering how these creatures look under the skin, I think this makes a lot of sense. Think about it. The female entices men to go into the liquid. It consumes their meat and insides, the structure of their body, but leaves the skin, leaves it floating in the black liquid. We know from her walking across it that this liquid can harden. So maybe this liquid hardens inside these floating sacks of flesh, creating a perfect mold to fill and pilot the skin. After this, the only addition required is a set of fake eyes to cover the blackness in the empty sockets. Also, in the beginning of the movie, there are only two aliens, one man and one woman. But towards the end, there are many more men at least. There's a whole crew of motorcycle men. What if these new members of this alien group were created with the skin of the men she trapped in the liquid? This would mean that the female's job, much like the Ant Queen, is to grow her army. This also means all the aliens are made of the same black liquid. They're all just parts in a collective. They have no individuality nor identity. But that's enough on the specifics of the world, because I don't think the fake alien woman and the black liquid and all of the rules of this universe are important to understanding what I think this film is really about. The possible explanations of the alien race, well, they belong in the top layer of this film, in its surface story, its skin. What matters here is what's under the skin of this film, the layers beneath, you know, the film's meaning, its identity. Which again is what I think this film is about. Identity. Look at all the shots of the eyes, the universal symbol for identity. Look at all the names of the characters. None of them really have names. They have no individuality. They have no identity. In my interpretation, this film isn't about searching for beauty beneath the skin. It's about searching for anything beneath the skin. Except, there's nothing under the skin to find. At least for the character within this story. This is the struggle that's presented here. Think about it. The only thing that distinguishes the aliens from one another is their stolen human skin. Underneath, they are nothing. And due to specific things that happen to the female that trigger certain feelings she shouldn't be having, the female is startled by this fact. And I think this could be representative of real feelings that real women, real people, have. This is really what I want to get to with this video. Think about what this story says if we look at it as an allegory. Because it isn't only fake alien people who struggle with their lack of humanity. In fact, plenty of real people struggle with it too. Real people can feel that whatever they are, if anything, is something completely different from everyone around them. They feel foreign, like an alien, and no matter how hard they try, they can't bridge the gap. They can't connect with people. All they can do is use people. Feed on people, hoping that it'll fill the void inside. Even though their stories may not involve sci-fi elements at all, real people can experience struggles and feelings much like the female alien in this film. I can think of many ways this sci-fi story could translate to reality. One interpretation I have is that the female could be representative of a woman who's trapped in a relationship. Trapped in a relationship with a bad man. A bad boy, you know, with the motorcycle and all. He's controlling and manipulative. Being trapped like she is, she feels like she's completely alone in the world. No one is there to help her or connect with her. On top of this, she feels as if she's lost her own identity. Like the very core of who she is defined by this toxic relationship. She tries to find herself by going out and flirting, and ultimately teasing random men that give her attention. She can't connect with these men, but at least they're in awe of her beauty. This feels good to her, because it's all she has. She may feel like she doesn't have an identity under the skin, but at least she has that good-looking skin. At least she still has the power to hypnotize random men with her looks. Eventually, she meets a man who she can connect with. He is as lonely and ostracized as she is. She lets him in, lets him see more of her than the others. This finally gives her the courage to leave her abusive boyfriend, to go out on her own and find herself. When the boyfriend learns of this, he punishes this other man and, of course, chases after this female. But she's not turning back. She wants to discover who she is. And in the process of her being out on her own and trying to find herself, of course, a new man, a nice man who is nothing like her, tries to help her when she's out in the cold. He tries to connect with her, to teach her how to love, but she's too broken. She runs away from him too, into a dangerous place she shouldn't have ventured. She's assaulted soon after, destroyed both inside and out. Before, her sense of identity came from her skin, her beauty, her sexual worth. But now, in her eyes, even that is destroyed. Another interpretation I have of this story is that it could be an allegory of a prostitute. Essentially, it's all the same as the alien being an abused girlfriend story, but instead of the bad man being her boyfriend, he could be something like a controlling, abusive pimp. In this scenario, it's not that she flirts with men to feel something, or at least that's not primarily why she does it. She does it because it's her job. The men are her meal tickets. She uses them to survive, both physically as well as mentally. And then, this movie also makes me think a lot about borderline personality disorder. Now again, this is just my interpretation. I know it's a possibility that none of this was intended, but still, I want to share what comes to mind when I watch this film. Maybe some of you out there have thought something similar. But anyway, borderline personality disorder. It's primarily a female personality disorder. Doesn't always have to be, just like how I think the meaning of this film doesn't always have to apply to females. It can apply to all genders, but still, it is worth saying that it usually impacts females. Its major symptoms include an unclear or shifting self-image, a chronic feeling of emptiness, unstable relationships, impulsive, self-destructive behaviors. A girl with BPD is also more likely to have a history of sexual abuse. She also likely has a horrific fear of abandonment, resulting in her wanting other people to need her more than she could ever need them. She could do this by finding pathetic, lonely men who are sure to worship the ground she walks on. She craves constant adoration from as many sources as possible, anything to not feel alone. Yet alone is how she often feels. Usually, she feels isolated from others, so she surrounds herself with men and uses them to build herself up. She collects men, feeds off of them. She always knows what to say to get them to like her, and to get them to think that she likes them. She flirts and teases, and gives them hope for something more, then moves on to the next as soon as she gets bored. Sucking the life out of men is the only thing she knows how to do. She struggles with real love, and really with connecting to people in general. And deep down, she struggles even more with keeping a coherent or consistent sense of self. The only way she can consistently define herself is with her looks, her primary tool for capturing men. Since she struggles to find an identity under the skin, she keeps the skin that she can see as polished and pretty as possible. It's beyond vanity. She must be the prettiest girl in the room, even if it means developing something like an eating disorder. But of all the borderline symptoms and behaviors, I think there's one that's probably the most well-known. It's a term called splitting. It's also called borderline thinking or polarized thinking. Putting it as simply as I can, it basically is the tendency to see things in black or white, in extremes. Was there anything you noticed about the colors used in this movie? That's right, there was a lot of pure black and pure white. If I was going to pick my best piece of evidence for why I think this movie is commenting on borderline personality disorder, it would be the usage of black and white. But that doesn't mean that that's all those colors can mean. I see black and white representing plenty of other things in this movie, too. The black is the emptiness, the lack of individualism, the lack of identity behind the eyes. The black is nothingness, while the white is creation, birth, soul. Different things in the movie can mean different things. They can mean multiple things at the same time. I mean, that's why I like art like this so much. It's just, you know, it really does speak to you. It changes every time you watch it. It really is the perfect way to be open to interpretation. But, okay, this video is already way too long. I need to wrap it up. I think Under the Skin is an investigation into those who struggle with identity. I think it's an examination of women, or really people in general, who feast on others to fill the emptiness inside. Now, yes, I recognize this could be way off the mark. Maybe the fact that I've studied plenty of psychology and known some crazy women in my life has biased me to seeing things in the film that aren't really there. Maybe this movie has nothing to do with women trapping men or identity crises or any of that. Maybe it's just about a sexy murderous alien and all the artsy stuff is meaningless. I mean, plenty of critics did call this film pretentious when it came out. But to this I say no. I think the critics are wrong. It's not that the film pretends to be deep. It's that the critics pretend to have imaginations. Alright, that's all I can really think of to say about this movie. So, thanks for watching. Like, subscribe, all that stuff. Share the video, please. And I think that's about it. Thanks again, guys.